Why is it so difficult to get to Callisto? In the vast cosmos that stretches beyond our planet, Callisto, Jupiter's second largest moon, presents a fascinating destination for human exploration. From an internal ocean beneath its surface to a size that borders on the planetary scale, Callisto is an icy, distant world that could represent the next place we look for extraterrestrial life and perhaps a future colony of humanity. If Callisto is such an essential place for the human race, why haven't we sent rovers to explore its surface as we have on Mars? Perhaps it's tough to get to Callisto? Stay with us to find out. Callisto is Jupiter's second largest moon after Ganymede and the third largest moon in the solar system after Ganymede and Titan. Callisto has a diameter of about 4,800 kilometers, almost as large as Mercury. Still, despite its size, it only has a third of the mass of Mercury, so its gravity is small in comparison. This is because Mercury has a massive iron core, while Callisto also has metal in its core, but in a smaller proportion. A satellite with a lot of history. Callisto's ancient surface is one of the most cratered in the solar system. The density of the craters is close to saturation. Any new crater will tend to erase an older one. It's like a minefield full of impact craters. Large-scale geology is relatively simple. Callisto has no large mountains, volcanoes, or other technological structures. Impact craters and multi-ring structures, along with fractures and scarps, are the only prominent features found on the surface. The fact that the impact craters on the surface of Callisto remain intact means that this satellite lacks geological activity or an atmosphere that produces erosion. So, for a long time, it was thought that Callisto was a wasteland without life or anything interesting to offer. But this changed with the era of space exploration missions. When the Voyager probes flew close to Jupiter in the 1970s and 80s, they managed to capture images from this satellite and found something interesting on the surface of Callisto. Among all the craters on this natural satellite, one called Valhalla stands out. This is the biggest multi-ring impact crater in the solar system. It consists of a bright central region 360 kilometers wide, an inner ridge, and a depression zone with fantastic concentric rings that extend to approximately 1,900 kilometers from the center. This was the crater that Voyager probes managed to photograph, and as soon as the images reached NASA's scientists, it was striking that such a significant impact crater could remain so well preserved. The multi-ring structure of Valhalla crater was likely the result of a giant impact, which pierced the moon's outer lithosphere and entered the underlying layer consisting of a much softer material. According to estimates, everything seems to indicate that the impact that produced this crater occurred approximately 4 billion years ago, that is, almost the age of the Earth. How can it be that it has remained intact for so long? The reason is that in the solar system, those celestial bodies that do not have geology or atmosphere preserve what happens on their surfaces for longer. An example of this is our natural satellite, the Moon. Since it doesn't have an atmosphere that erodes the soil like Earth does, everything that happens on the surface of the Moon stays there forever. That's why the astronauts' footprints who went to the Moon are still there and will remain there for thousands of years until some meteorite impact erases them. The impact that caused Valhalla crater occurred billions of years ago. Still, because there's no erosion or geological activity, this crater has remained intact ever since, making it a time capsule that will allow us to understand better how the solar system formed. An ocean of possibilities. The first space probes to visit Callisto were Pioneer 10 and Pioneer 11, which passed close to Jupiter in the early 70s. Still, since very little was known about Callisto, both spacecraft passed by and captured little information about the satellite, as they did not consider it a priority. The real breakthrough in Callisto's information came later with the flybys of Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 in 1979. These two spacecrafts took images of more than half of Callisto's surface with a 1 to 2 kilometer resolution and accurately measured its temperature, mass, and shape. This data provided us with the first views of Callisto, and then scientists became more interested in the satellite. Subsequently, between 1994 and 2003, the Galileo spacecraft had 8 close encounters with Callisto, taking photographs of its surface at a distance of only 138 kilometers and obtaining the sharpest images of Callisto up to that time. The Galileo orbiter completed global imaging of Callisto's surface and delivered several images with a resolution of up to 15 meters. In 2000, the Cassini spacecraft acquired high-quality infrared spectra from Galilean satellites, including Callisto, en route to Saturn. Later in February and March of 2007, the New Horizons probe, on its way to Pluto, obtained new images and spectra of Callisto. In recent years, NASA's Juno mission, designed to study Jupiter and its moons, has continued to shed light on the mysteries of Callisto. Equipped with state-of-the-art instruments, the Juno probe has mapped the topography and composition of the moon of Jupiter, providing essential information for future exploration missions. Thanks to all the space missions that obtained information about Callisto, scientists discovered that this satellite responds to Jupiter's variable background magnetic field as it is a perfectly conductive sphere. That is, the field cannot penetrate inside Callisto, which could mean that there is a layer of highly conductive fluid inside with a thickness of at least 10 kilometers. What fluid could cause this behavior? You guessed it, water. Well, more specifically, salt water. As you heard, did you think Europa was the only moon with water? Well, it turns out that no, Callisto also has water, and in a large quantity. An internal ocean in Callisto is more likely if the water contains a small amount of ammonia or other antifreeze. In this case, the layer of water plus ice beneath the surface of Callisto could be between 250 and 300 kilometers thick. Since astronomers discovered that Callisto possessed an internal ocean, there has been increased interest in studying this icy world. Further, the water is one of the primary resources for life to emerge. If there is water in Callisto, it may also have extraterrestrial life forms. Or not. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. Callisto's habitability. Although it's not as famous a moon as Titan or Europa, Callisto has water, enough for scientists to set their sights on it. Observation of Callisto's inner ocean do not provide us with much information about it, as several factors could influence its temperature and density. Some scientists speculate that even under the worst conditions, microbial life could thrive within Callisto's inner ocean, an example of which is found here on Earth, and that is halophils. Halophils are microscopic organisms that can survive in environments with high salt concentrations. If these organisms can thrive in places with a lot of salt on Earth, why can't they do the same on Callisto? However, some scientists think Callisto lacks the conditions to host living things because it's too cold. Other moons, such as Europa, obtain heat from the tidal forces exerted by Jupiter, but Callisto orbits Jupiter much farther than Europa. Of the four Galilean moons, Callisto is the one that orbits farthest from Jupiter, and it is the only moon that is not in resonance with the others. Jupiter's Galilean moons have a resonance of 1 to 2 to 4, meaning that for every orbit Ganymede completes, Europa completes 2 and Io completes 4. Meanwhile, Callisto is not in resonance with any of the other three and is much farther away, so it does not perceive tidal forces like the other three moons. The only source of heat from Callisto's ocean is radioactive decay. It is thought this is insufficient to generate the heat living things need, so Callisto's internal ocean would be too cold even for microbial organisms. Although the idea that Callisto's internal ocean is habitable is attractive to the entire scientific community, for now it is not possible to know, and the only way to find out if this satellite has the conditions to host living beings is to send a mission specifically designed to study it in depth. So why aren't we sending space missions to study this fascinating natural satellite? The answer is that yes, we are doing it. But this is NASA's Juno mission that's currently orbiting Jupiter to study the planet and its satellites. But the mission that will answer the questions with more precision will be the JUICE mission that is on its way to Jupiter's moon system. The Jupiter Icy Moons Explorer, or JUICE mission, was launched on April 14, 2023. And is expected to reach Jupiter in July of 2031. This will be the first spacecraft in history to thoroughly study the Galilean moons and search for any trace of life. Of course, sending a spacecraft as far away as Jupiter is not easy, so the JUICE mission will take almost 9 years to reach the Galilean moons. But once it is put into orbit, it will begin a process of exhaustive investigation that will look for all the signs and clues that will help us determine once and for all whether Callisto could be a habitable world or the future home of humanity. Could Callisto be humanity's future home? In 2003, NASA conducted a conceptual study called Human Outer Planets Exploration, HOPE, on future human exploration of the outer solar system. The target chosen to consider this mission was Callisto. This satellite was chosen for different reasons. It is one of the three largest moons in the solar system, so it has acceptable gravity for humans. It is orbiting Jupiter, which places it halfway between the inner and the outer planets, and it is far enough away from Jupiter's magnetosphere that it does not receive as much radiation as other satellites closer to Jupiter, such as Europa. NASA's conceptual design proposed a possible surface base at Callisto that would produce fuel for rockets heading to planets farther out in the solar system, such as Uranus and Neptune. The advantages of a base on Callisto include low radiation, due to its distance from Jupiter, and geological stability, since it doesn't have volcanoes like Io. Such a base could facilitate the exploration of Europa or be an ideal location for a Jovian system way station to surface spacecraft going deeper into the outer solar system, using the gravitational assistance of a close flyby of Jupiter after departing from Callisto. Thanks to this idea, in December of 2003, NASA reported that a human-crewed mission to Callisto could be possible in the 2040s. Of course, this project is still beyond the reach of modern technology. Traveling to Callisto is very difficult, both because of the distances and the time it takes us to get there. But if we keep moving forward on the right path, maybe one day we will make it. Now, we want your opinion. Do you consider that one day humanity will manage to establish a space base in Callisto? Do you think the following missions to Jupiter will find signs of life on the Galilean moons? Let us know what you think in the comments.